All right. If we're going to spend some time watching a video, we better make sure that it's time well spent. So let's set the stage to make that possible. First of all, we acknowledge that we have a severe continuity problem, which requires patience and reason, because you're not going to be able to accept what is said on a continual basis. You can get it, and then you won't get it. And then you have to, at that point, don't struggle with it. Just allow the feeling, I call it the burn sort of in you. Don't struggle with it mentally. Just say, wow, this is tough to process. Just let it, be patient with it. This is the way that the acknowledging that you have the continuity problem. It's really the only problem we have. The other, what we also have to do is be in the mood of repentance, which is to be humble and recognize that we try to be greater than God, and that's the root of our problems, actually. We try to separate from God, and that we know this doesn't work. We know it doesn't work. We're fundamentally realize our only problem is the continuity problem, but it's a very severe problem. And so we're just sort of returning, going in reverse, as it were, returning back, letting go of our, well, I'll explain it here. The mood of repentance is how you process information. That's all important. The non-repentant spirit, who still has the pride, still says, "We can do this. We can find a way." They cannot process information properly, and so it's a waste of time. Actually, if you're not in a mood of repentance and listening to any sort of sharing of information, then it's not going to be beneficial. Really, very very little benefit. So we give ourselves time, set the stage by giving ourselves time to settle in and process the information in the right way, which is non-argumentative, non-discursive, non-dialogue, non-discussing, non-struggling. We don't process it with the intellect or the emotions. We process it with reason and spiritual intuition. And we let it just be. Just let the information be. Let the presence of the information be. Now, one more issue here to set the stage is there's from the standpoint of what I'm saying, there's only one teacher, and that's the Holy Spirit. That's it. There are no other teachers. There are those who share how the Holy Spirit's helping them, but ultimately, the real teacher is the Holy Spirit. We are not called to be teachers, actually. The Holy Spirit is always with everyone, never forsakes anyone. To the very end, the Holy Spirit will save everyone without exception. That's not our role. Our role is to accept our own salvation, okay? To listen to the Holy Spirit and be advised properly. Listen, follow the guidance of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is always with us, and never takes a vacation, never takes a break. It is with us 100% of the time, always and forever. And that's with everyone, without exception. So we don't have the responsibility of being teachers at all. So what we're doing here is what I'm going to do is just share some information that the Holy Spirit has given me. Just to give you the flavor, and then the processing of it is just allow the presence, the feel of this information to be there and experience it. Don't try to say, okay, I got it, now what? No, we have a continuity fear. We got it, and now we're doing the dance of rationalization, of backing away. Be aware of that. Be aware of it and say, no, I'm just backing away for a moment. I don't buy into the rationalization. So you can tell how you're listening by if you say if you're listening and say, oh yeah, okay, I got it, I got that, I got that. That's the unrepentant mind upset. Whereas if you hear it and you just like, are like struck by it, just like, holy cow, like stunned by it, and you're just quiet, then you're getting it. You're getting it. You should be stunned by the information. If it's not stunning, it's not worth listening to, actually. And when you're stunned, you're quiet. You're quiet, and you're absorbing the shock of this information, because this information is going to be very shocking. At the same time, incredibly great information. So, as we adjust to this ordeal, being shocked, stunned by information is an ordeal. We give ourselves a little time. We're not in an academic, say, okay, what's the answer? Just give me the answer. I can get it. What is the unrepentant mind, spirit, unrepentant spirit? What is it after? It's after solving problems. Okay, it wants answers. It wants answers. Okay. This is the trouble. This doesn't work. What the Holy Spirit's guidance will lead us towards is to accept the experiencing of the non-arising of any problems. The non-arising of problems. What we need to get to is to say, I don't need problems. So I don't need the arising of problems. Abiding in the vision of oneness is to abide in the non-arising of problems. So this is a new definition we're being given here, and we need to adjust to this. We don't need to solve any problems. Reality has no problems. We don't have, our true identity has no problems. What we need to do is get used to this, used to the non-arising of problems. This is the intermediate step. Now, we might say that this seems like, wow, wait a minute, there's two paths. One is to experience the non-arising of problems. The other is to experience problems arising and then trying to solve them. And we might say, well, what happens if I am experiencing the non-arising of problems and that doesn't work? Then I'll be way behind because I haven't learned how to solve problems. Okay, that's the fear that we have. The answer is that the experiencing the non-arising of problems, that is what works. And the trying to solve, have experienced problems arising, trying to solve them, doesn't work, will never work. That's the losing way. That's the way that loses. It's the dead end. There are no problems with reality. So in order to solve our continuity fear, we have to begin to experience this, that there aren't any problems. So this is the winning path. This is the path that wins. And you have to have belief and trust in that enough to accept it. That's the tough part that we struggle with. We want to do both ways. You say, yeah, I want that, but I also want to be really good at solving problems. That doesn't work. Sitting on the fence doesn't work. We call experiencing, you know, the non-arising of problems, abiding in the non-dual absolute, or non-dual absolute abidance, where you're aware that there aren't any problems at all. No problems are arising. Now, if you have a desire to experience problems and fix them, it will seem that there's, oh, I see a problem there. I see a problem. Let me go and fix that problem. That's an interesting problem that's arising. But, and then you're not experiencing the non-arising of problems anymore. But we are entirely capable of experiencing the non-arising of problems, actually. And again, just let this information sit there as it is. Don't try to add or subtract to it. Or say, well, how do we do that? No, just the information is It is possible for us to experience the non-arising of problems. Full stop with that. Full stop. And that is the answer that we've been looking for. The answer that we've been looking for is to abide in the non-arising of problems. Full stop with that information. And so you can see there are two very divergent ways, right? Those who want to see problems arise and then try to fix them have their way, they'll continue on with the universe. Those who realize that the answer is to experience the non-arising of problems, no problems arising at all, obviously they will go to the path of transcending the universe, not needing it at all. Gradually, they may find themselves in some very fortuitous circumstances, and people say, wow, you're so fortunate. It's incredible good fortune. Well, because I paid attention to the Holy Spirit all these years, listened and tried to hear what it had to say, what its advice was, to entertain its advice and just say, wow, that's so different than what the world is saying. Wow. And just get used to it. So of course if you put in all this time of familiarity training, you're going to find what the world thinks is very fortuitous circumstances, where you find yourself in a place where this is just very problematical free. I mean, free of problems. You seem to be more and more and more free of problems. But not because you've solved any problems, because you've accepted the way of abiding in no problems arising, the non-dual absolute abidance, where you see for sure, say, oh, there aren't any problems at all. There are no problems arising. Just wow. Now, the external circumstances that people think you have a body, you're in a world, whatever, that is just staging for others. When you dwell in the non-dual absolute, you don't need any of that really. But for the sake of letting others see this and something that's going on, then you have an appearance in a world. But that appearance can be take on the appearance of being very problem free without needing to fix any. Everything just seems to evaporate as you go through life. All the problems just evaporate. Others insist on seeing you as having problems. Because how else are you going to help them? If they think that you're sharing their problems, because the unrepentant believe that solving problems is the answer. And I've gone over this in other videos previously. I can go over it a little bit here again. Is when we wanted to be separate from God, then we saw God as, we have tried to objectify reality, tried to objectify everything. Reality is all there is. We said, let's see if we can objectify it. And if we could objectify it, that means we were then, it's an object to us, the subject. So we would be then prior to, greater to God, separate from, other than. So in our attempt to objectify or define as other, all that is, this attempt mentally gave the mind chaotic, endless chaos arises for the mind when we try to objectify all that is. Endless chaos. And again, full stop with this information. Don't try to struggle with it. Each step, these like a step, just take the step. I say, that's just full step, I took the step, that's all. Okay, now let's get ready for the next step. With this endless chaos, this is intolerable for spirit and the mind. And so what happened was spirit and mind has defended against this, experiencing this, by thinking that there's some way, other way, and this is time and space, invented, imagined, dreamed time and space as a defense against this endless chaos, saying we can organize this chaos. And the space and time is just a dream of organization, of organizing. So that we believe that by organizing all space and time, so everything is just the way we want it all organized, classified and named and defined, that then we can have our cake and eat it too. We can have objectify all that is and still be happy with it. You see, not have it be endless chaos. So what we're searching for is our problems to solve. Okay. We want problems to be arising. The whole purpose of the universe is to ceaselessly give us problems that we can define and then work on. And this defends us against the fear of endless chaos. Now this is the unrepentant spirit saying, no, I still want to be greater than God. I think there's a way, and the way is this universe. Now when we repent and say, I don't need to be greater than God, I can drop that desire, it's a foolish desire, foolish whim that I had, then there is no problem of endless mental chaos. There's no need then to try and fragment all that into little pieces, little problems, which we call the universe, and then to work on these problems and define and organize and structure and how do I survive this problem. There's no need for a universe at all. No need for a universal dream at all. So we no longer need to experience problems arising. And if we're not experiencing problems arising, we certainly don't need to solve any problems either, do we? So this is the path of salvation. Path of salvation. And we kind of go in reverse, where we feel less and less problems arising, less and less. The universe appears to be more and more problem-free. And it's like effortlessly. Path of grace, it's called. Path of miracles, as Jesus calls it. Why he calls it A Course in Miracles, is this effortless, without you needing to do anything. The Holy Spirit does it for you. The Holy Spirit arranges time and space to suit you in terms of where you're at, in terms of problems. And so the Holy Spirit is able to rearrange time and space, which is only a dream, instantly for you. And so you don't need to do anything. You just need to abide in that you see no problems arising. Problem-free, no problems are arising, no problems are arising. And this abidance in the non-dual absolute is a perspective where you literally see that. It's true. Nothing is distancing itself from being at all. This is a fact. What we do is we take appearances as to be being, and then we see appearances distancing themselves from other appearances. So we take like the I, this body, as the center of being, and we see everything in relation to this form here, and then it seems like it's completely problematical. But really, the ground of being is pure spaciousness. It's not form. And so from the standpoint of pure spaciousness, nothing is distancing itself or getting out of alignment with pure spaciousness at all. So there are no problems of being at all. And since we are being, we're pure being, there are no problems at all arising from reality. We have just invented this notion of problems between forms, between appearances. Appearances really don't have any problems in terms of being at all. But you have to experience it. You cannot get it intellectually. You have to experience this vision of oneness, this non-dual absolute perspective. And then you'll realize, oh wow, there's never been anything, nothing's ever happened. There's never been any path. There's no path. There's never been any problem. There's never been any path to solve problems. Nothing's ever happened with appearance. There aren't any problems. There's never been any problems. You see that. You actually see it. Now, of course, for one who believes salvation depends upon recognizing problems and solving it, this will completely freak them out. So they're not going to abide in the non-dual absolute perspective. They will not. They will continue on in their prideful, not unrepentant ways, trying to say, I think they're parsing the chaos out in many, in huge, you know, ways, separate it all out, little piece here, little piece there, little piece there. Bodies, worlds, problems, survival, let's work on all this stuff and gradually build up, you know, ways of dealing with survival problems, etc. That's endless, endless futility, endless futility. It's just, it is much ado about nothing, actually. It's all for naught. And you can see that, and that it never went anywhere. Never accomplished anything. Universe never will never accomplish anything. So there's no point in seeing a problematical universe. What we need to see is a problem-free universe. And we can do that simply by shifting our attention, shifting our perspective. Not through solving any problems. It's shifting your attention is the remedy, not solving any problems. Now this is the saying that has been shared before in history in terms of the basics, but the emphasis in the context and the clarity is different here. I like this clarity better, actually. That's why I'm doing it. It explains more. It gives a fuller, richer context where you can just say, wow, okay, I understand, you know, better what's going on here. I can trust it more. But it is essentially the same narrative here. As like a Srinivasagadatta Maharaja, you know, his attitude, well, the world, the body, what is that? I don't need that. It's nothing to do with me at all, which is true. It has nothing to do with us whatsoever, actually. Problems, what problems? Like Sri Ananda Mahamaya would say, there are no problems. Everything's perfect. That's right. There's nothing is separating from God. There's no separation from God taking place whatsoever. They're just a play of appearance, is all it is. Longchenpa, just a play of appearance. Arising and subsiding. There's no problem with arising and subsiding. And Jesus, forgiveness. Nothing ever happened to us. Nothing, no one ever, there's no guilt. There's no sin, there's no guilt. Everything we've done to ourselves, trying to find a way to solve the problem of endless chaos. But the endless chaos is just a reaction to a desire on our part. It's not really a problem, because it's inherently, inextricably, one with the desire to be greater than God. So it's not a problem. A problem, by definition, is something that is addressed in terms of solving it. But there is no, you cannot separate this reaction of endless chaos from the desire to be separate from God. You cannot separate it at all. So it's not a problem. It's not a problem at all. It just is what it is. As long as we want to try to be separate, greater than God, this reaction will always arise. There's no way it cannot arise. We're just trying to turn it into a problem and thinking that we can solve it bit by bit through time and space. We cannot. We can't do anything to it. You see, but since we think that we can separate from God, we think we can separate this reaction to our desire to be separate from God. We think we can separate that too. We cannot. Not only can we not separate from God, we cannot separate this reaction of endless chaos from the desire to be separate from God. We can't separate it at all. So it's not a problem. There's nothing that needs to be done to it. We just change our mind. Repent means change our mind, change our desire. Repent is to change your desire, what you want. And then we're just faced with this continuity issue. Like, wow, I'm so used to problem solving in the universe and everything. How do I set it all down? Well, gradually the Holy Spirit will set it down for you, actually. Gradually. Our job is just to abide in the non-dual absolute perspective. Be willing to do that. Be willing to do that. And how all these external form, how the play of appearance winds down, that's the Holy Spirit's job. It's not our job. Should we not be concerned with that? And again, full stop on all this information. You get it and then full stop with it. Don't try to do anything with it. Don't try to use it to solve problems. You see? Don't try to use any of this information to solve problems. Just let it be. Just let it be there. Because that's what we're ultimately, our goal is just to be, just to be aware of the non-arising of problems. There's no problems arising at all. And just be aware, oh, this is not a problem. This is not a problem. There's no arising of problems here. There's no arising of problems there. There's no arising of problems, you know, just, wow. I remember when I got pulled down into trying to solve the world's problems, where I got to a point where I saw problems everywhere. Everything was a problem. Every last situation I saw was a problem. There were problems literally everywhere. And I was just completely overwhelmed. My mind was trying to solve, classify, organize. How can I organize these problems? How can I classify them? How can I say, okay, this is over here, this is here, this is here. It's like this massive jumble of chaos of problems. That's the egoic perspective. And the ego teaches, well, you just have to, you know, give it more time and work on one problem at a time, that kind of thing. The ego has all this advice about how to succeed. And it calls it spiritual advice, actually, most of the time. It's egoic advice. It's unrepentant, prideful, unacknowledged continuity fear advice. Doesn't work. Full stop. It doesn't work. Full stop. So this world, what they ask you is, well, how do we solve our problems? So you try to come in this world, if you try to hold, you know, bring the truth to this world, it can be quite difficult. Because people say, well, what you're saying, but how do we solve our problems? And you say, you don't have to. So what are you talking about? Well, we'll be suffering then. No, you won't. You'll be experiencing the non-arising of problems. That's the answer. The answer is to experience the non-arising of problems. I say, well, it's impossible. No, Holy Spirit makes it possible. And we say, no, we want to be in control of solving our problems. Well, turn it over to, you've heard that, give it to God. Turn it over to God. Turn it over to the Holy Spirit, actually. Let the Holy Spirit solve the problems. Now, you may say, well, you've tried to do that. It hasn't worked. That's something that I say often. Well, I haven't truly turned it over then to the Holy Spirit. Because the ego still wants to say, well, I want to find out how to solve these problems. I want to be intelligent. See, we think that intelligence means solving problems. No, that's actually foolishness. If you go along with this effort to solve problems, all you're doing is you're spending time in the company of fools and foolishness. That's all you're doing. And the answer to, well, the unrepentant says, we'll never repent. We'll never repent. We're not going to do that. Well, eventually you get tired of spending your time in the company of fools. You get tired of foolishness and fools. Definitely you do. You say, wow, I'm so tired of hanging out with fools. It's just not it. And then you repent. So everyone does repent. Foolishness is very boring, very tiring, very unappealing. Even being queen of the fools is very, very boring and tiring. So even the great goddess queen will eventually tire of this, trying to play that role for sure. So it doesn't matter, no matter how defiant spirit is, unrepentant spirit is, prideful spirit is, saying, no, we're gonna make the universe into this jewel-like home for us. We'll never drop the universe. We'll solve all the problems. We'll be so inspired. We'll have this beautiful goddess idol to worship, and we're gonna do it, and we're never, never going to drop this. No matter how defiant they are, believe me, time weighs heavy upon spirit. In the company of fools, it grinds you down, and you just eventually just say, wow, can't take any more of this. Forget it. Holy Spirit, help. So it's all bluster. It's all bluster. So the world thinks, hey, you know, we've devised this world that is just throwing like massive problems on us. It's like the health insurance and Medicare and all this kind of stuff. It is so complex. It is so confusing. You know, you almost want to just die. So I don't even want to bother with this stuff. So the world seems to just be throwing these, you know, endless problems. I remember how healthcare used to be so simple. I could just get $20. I want to go. I walk in any doctor's office. I said, whatever specialist, we've got a problem. If you have a problem, I'd like to have an appointment. Oh, sure. Okay. Appointment. All right. There. Okay. Doctor, I'll see you in a couple days. You go in the doctor and say, what's the problem? Okay. Here, we'll fix it. That'll be, you know, $50, $100, or depending on what, you know, whatever. Or, you know, sliding scale. Sometimes you don't have the money. The doctor said, well, what can you afford? That's it. That's it. Now, insurance was introduced to handle the real costly, as we did more and more costly procedures, fixing more and more problems, right? Then, you know, the hospitals had to bill more and more and more. But we've gotten into just an insane situation with healthcare, actually. Super problematic. But that's what the world wants. The world wants that. So one of the remedies is just to experience the non-arising of problems in your body. As far as the body goes, there's no arising of problems at all. Just be aware of the non-arising. And you might say, well, what happens to the problems you already have? Let the Holy Spirit take care of that. It's interesting. And then full stop with this. Full stop. Know when to do the full stop when you're listening. And I have to be aware of that too, to help out. Just wow, the shock. What we say is, well, how do I get the problems back if I need them? I want to be in control because I want to get them back. Well, if you really ask for them, of course, the Holy Spirit will give them back, right? But the whole thing about this healthcare and everything, actually, this whole thing is designed for you to have problems, physical problems, health problems, so that all this expertise to solving problems can be applied. And this is very evident. You know, I accompany people to doctors all the time, and I'm aware of the whole situation. It's like, you're supposed to have problems. You're supposed to get sick. You're supposed to have insurance. You're supposed to go to these. You're supposed to have surgery. I've never had any surgery. I told someone that, and the guy said, what? He says, very unusual. Your age, I'm taking no medications. I've never had any surgery. I've never had many, nothing like that. I did have one tooth extracted. But, okay, so I guess you could say there's that exception. But they say that this med tech was like, wow. And if you talk to like people in like doctors and pharmacists and med tech people, if they'll actually confide in you, you know, if they can tell that you'll accept what they have to say. And they're like freaked out, actually. Very freaked out. and they say, hey, at all costs, avoid medical procedures. At all costs, avoid medicines. At all costs, if you can. They say, this whole thing is rigged. It's a scam. And they say, it's bad. It's really bad, actually. They'll actually confide in you. And this has been happening. And if you're sophisticated and going along with this program, you're supposed to have problems. You're supposed to have problems. Same thing with debt and money. I got pulled into that. I said, let me see what's going on here. You're supposed to have debt. You're supposed to have problems. So that this whole mechanism of solving problems has something to work on. The last thing this world wants is somebody here that doesn't have any problems. They hate that. In fact, they ignore it. Huh? Oh, you don't belong here. Yeah. No, you're supposed to be problematical. So the problem solvers can go to work. This is the duality, the problem solving and the problem, the problem and the problem solving. If there's no problems arising, there's no need for any problem solving. Like if everyone here was like perfectly healthy, there's no need for doctors. There's no need for hospitals. There's no need for medical care. There's no need for insurance. On and on and on and on and on, right? Again, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma said, whatever happened with her, the play is what we wanted. But she says, I don't have any needs. I don't have any problems. I don't need to eat. Physically, she said, my functioning actually doesn't have any needs at all. Body doesn't have any needs. I don't need to sleep at all. No need for sleep. I don't even need for shelter. I don't have any needs. I can't be harmed. I can't be really sick. But for your sake, I will pretend that this is so. So she got illnesses and sicknesses a lot because that's what the people expected of her, the body, here. You know, so she acted like she was problematical because that's what people demanded here. But on the same hand, when it became also effective to not be problematical, her problems would vanish instantly. This is very important. The life of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma is extremely important to study this life, which I did. Because it was just totally amazing what happened. She had this cancer metastasized throughout her whole system, and she had cancer growing everywhere in her body. And the doctor said, this is like one of the worst cancers I've ever seen. And you're gonna die in a matter of a couple days. This is just, you know, horrific. And the pain must be terrible. And she says, there's no pain. I feel completely blissful. There's no problem whatsoever. And they said, no, I got to give you morphine. Well, of course, when you start giving patients morphine, it shuts down their system. If you work in the hospice care, you know that when you go in hospice, when you start taking morphine, that's the end. Your whole system shuts down. So the doctor said, I got to give you morphine. She said, no, there's no reason for it. Everything's perfect. There's no trouble at all. And he thought she's crazy. So there's a very eminent doctor, the head of a hospital, a very, very elite hospital, the head of this very elite, I believe, very elite hospital. This is not just some, you know, whatever. This is some, you know, scientific, medical expert. And so he said, wow, I got to help her out. And so he came to give her a shot of morphine when she was sleeping at night, just to ease the pain before she died. As grace, you know, I just want to help you out. This is my duty as a doctor. And so he came in the middle of the night, and he saw her, and she was sitting upright in, you know, in a lotus posture, meditation posture, yogic posture, perfectly still and calm. And he goes, oh my God, she's not sleeping. Of course, she never slept, actually. She only closed her eyes and pretended to sleep. She said she never slept ever at all. Not even for a moment did she ever fall asleep in this world. Another amazing fact. And as he was watching in the darkness, the shadows there, looking into her room, he suddenly saw this bright flash of light and some dark form seeming to jump over a balcony and disappear off to the banks of the Ganges River or something. So he thought he saw this. And he was so shocked and stunned by what had happened. he fled back to his quarters, you know. And in the morning he got the courage to go back. He was really shaken, just totally, probably dead by now. And to his astonishment, she was there greeting visitors and everything, and there was not the slightest trace of cancer in her body. He examined her. No trace whatsoever. Whereas just hours before, her whole body had lumps everywhere of hideous cancer. Next morning, it had completely vanished without a trace. And she was not affected in the slightest bit, her emotions and everything. He's just like, what could he say? I guess she doesn't need a doctor. Because she doesn't need morphine. You know what I'm saying? Our spirit doesn't need any of the universe. Doesn't need any problems whatsoever. And when pure spirit, all spirit is pure, but when spirit appears in this world without any continuity fear whatsoever, as was the case there, then they take on these problems just to appear as if to reassure people, like, oh yeah, I need some problems too. But they really, really don't. They really don't. And so she said, well, when this phase of showing, pretending that I needed a problem, cancer, because people, that was in vogue. You see, we don't understand that we want problems so we can solve them. So cancer is very in vogue. Why do we have cancer? Because we want it. We want this problem so we can work on trying to solve it, because it represents a little bit of trying to get solve this problem of eternal chaos. Okay? So when the time was over for that, I said, okay, somehow the people say, okay, that's enough. Because she's going to, you know, die, her body's going to die, supposedly. In the spirit of this world, you know, they said, you know what? We don't need it that bad. We'd rather have you here, okay? They said, oh, you don't need it? Oh, okay. Phew, gone instantly. In a flash, in an instant. Gone. Vanished. It's just an appearance. Now, she said that these diseases have conscious types of consciousness. So there's some sort of form of consciousness left, or so to speak, at least to our way of looking at it. What's all that beeping? I'm going to check what's going on. That's a problem. Well, I'm not going to do that. No, forget it. This is absolutely true. When I study the life of Sri Sri Anandamayi, I got the evidence that was needed. And people, of course, if they're unrepentant, they're not going to look for evidence. But I got the evidence. I said, wow, she definitely gave us the evidence if we're just willing to accept it. You talk about a gold mine of evidence. That is it. Totally brings to light the deception, self-deceptions, what we're doing here. Again, eating the same things. Stopped eating. Didn't need to eat. People freaked out. Finally, she said, okay. I'll eat. I said, good. She said, what are you going to eat? I'll eat 3 grains of rice a day. And that was it. And then occasionally, people insisted she'd eat some fruit. And also, if they'd really press her on this, you must eat. She said, oh, okay. And what she'd do then is she'd start eating nonstop. And she'd consume enough food for like 50 people or something, and just wouldn't stop. And it completely freaked them out. She said, you're going to kill yourself. What are you doing? She goes, you told me to eat. You wanted me to eat. And they said, no. Okay. And it didn't affect her health at all. She would gain some weight, but she was able to eat incredible amounts of food without any bother whatsoever. Because to her, it's just an appearance. You want the appearance of me eating food? Fine. Okay, here, give me the 5 gallons of milk, and I'll just chug 5 gallons of ghee or whatever, you know. Whatever there was, she'd just eat it. Whatever there was in the house, oh, and she'd just eat all of it. Whatever, gone. Everything. And people are just completely freaking out. What are you doing? This is impossible. You're going to kill yourself. Stop. She said, you told me you want me to eat a lot. No, don't eat so much. Just eat whatever you want to eat. She goes, well, how about 3 grains of rice? Okay, that's fine. What an incredible opportunity those people had, really. Because I was fortunate enough to be able to study her life before all these books seem to just vanish and people are not interested anymore. But is the greatest example of spirit completely free of any continuity fear here in the world. The greatest example that we could actually study with actual, you know, pictures and videos and books and eyewitness accounts of people who are still living and very reputable people. And so it's just like, you know, you just say, wow. And I believed it. I believe what they said. And just unending such play of this play of, well, I don't have any needs, but you want me to appear to have some needs, so I'll do a little bit here. But I also want you to say, hey, maybe I don't need to do that much, and back off your demands. And it was this play. It was a Leela of Sadhana. It was a Leela, a play, playing with the devotees here. How much do you want to insist that I need? You know, and because I really don't need anything, but. Do you want that? No. We want you to have needs. Okay, well, let's bargain. There's always this play of bargaining, you know. She loved this play of bargaining. She enjoyed it. It's funny. A sense of humor about it. You want me to be sick? Oh, okay, great. I'll be sick. Oh, you don't like me being sick? Okay. You want me to speak? Okay, I'll speak and I'll tell you. Oh, you don't like what I'm saying? You don't want me to speak? Oh, okay, I won't speak. Then she goes silent. She says, I'm going to be silent for 3 years. And after like a couple months of, you know, this intense silence, people would say, please, you know, we want you to talk. We want you to tell us stuff. And they beg her, you know. And finally, then she'd start talking again. She didn't need to say anything. We're going to find out what that beeping is. It's just one. I don't think it's at our house, but whatever. The people around it, there's smoke. People will smell it, you know. And, you know, she said, I didn't come here to solve problems. What problems? No problems. I came here to show you there are no problems. And so, like when the plague, not the smallpox, was, you know, ravaging, there's so many issues in India during that time, and the famine of East Bengal, of course, was absolutely horrific. How many people starved to death during World War II when the scorched earth policy, you know, of the British, and thinking that the Japanese were going to invade East Bengal and get all the food and be able to set up, you know, a robust presence there. You know, the scorched earth policy. Well, what did that do to the people who live there? No food. Didn't want to have any boats, no way to distribute food. They tried to basically cripple the whole land. So if the Japanese got control of it, they couldn't function there. Well, the Japanese didn't get control of it, but the price they paid was, you know, this incredible famine, horrific famine. What, 1940 something, right? 42, 3, somewhere in there, something like that now. And also the provisions, all the rice provisions were sent over to other countries to help in the war effort. And so the people were just like, there's nothing to eat. And so they were telling her, help, you know, help. And she just was just a normal, blissful, no problem, everything's perfect. So didn't react to anything. But eventually she would do a few things and organize beautifully some relief efforts here and that, you know, just like, but no attachment to whatsoever. It's just that people said, we really want you to do that. So, and then in World War II also, they wanted to organize this, the Gayatri Mantra of a great, like saying it, you know, millions and millions and millions of times by about over 100 high priests or something. It was some huge effort to kind of smooth out the world so that peace could come. And so they asked her to organize that, and she did. But at the same time, she was completely detached from it, without seemingly, you know, any real interest in any outcome, actually. It's only because people were insisting that these are needs and problems that they have, and they couldn't relate to her unless she was pretending as if that these are needs and problems. So you played along with it, played along with it, played along with it. But at the same time, could instantly act as like there's absolutely nothing going on. I have no attachment, or I'm not doing anything. I'm not completely unaware of any problems or any. Of course, actually, it wasn't that she instantly switched that way. It was always that way. It's just that when people finally stopped demanding that she pretend that there'd be problems, then poof, they would see that she's completely problem-free. She's totally detached from anything, any notion. She's not even seeing any problems arising at all. And they say, whoa, that's too much. And I want to see you dealing with problems again. There's a play. Teachers come here to, not teachers, but those who have no continuity fear come to this world to play with us this way. She is the expert at it. Again, later in life, when old people would come to her and say, you know, you don't have the energy. I want you to come here and visit us, and I wish you would be young again. You know, we know that some people knew it was all pretense, aging. And she said, we know you're just pretending. And she says, yes, I know. And I have to, this is part of the play, you know, I have to pretend like this. And there are times when some who got it and said, you don't need to do this pretense for me right now. I don't need it. Suddenly, her whole appearance would change. Actually, it didn't change. The way we saw it, our demand for the appearance would change. And they'd see her as young, youthful, young, totally untouched by age. Totally untouched by age. And then she'd smile and laugh. Say, you say, yeah, that's exactly right. And they just say, wow. What is this? What a great Leela, what a great play that was. You know, it's just like, holy cow. But all credit to those people in India who are able to engage in that play. Because it certainly seems here in the West we're not able to engage in that play. There hasn't been anything like that. We're way too into solving problems. You got to understand the people of India who follow the Vedas and the Upanishads and the Bhagavad Gita and the Advaita Vedanta and Shankara's teachings and help and all of this, you know, the rishis, the gurus, all of this, they had got a lot of this permeated them, and they were very much in the feeling of there are no problems, I don't need to solve any problems. So they could entertain such an appearance, completely problem-free appearance, zero continuity fear. But they still had some continuity fear. But they could at least hang out with someone who had none. Hanging out with someone who has no continuity fear is the ultimate as far as a play in this world. Because then the evidence is overwhelming. You're getting direct evidence. With a body in a world, you're getting direct evidence. Again, bilocation, she did it all the time. And who knows, maybe trilocation, whatever, doesn't matter. Because she had no need to be here, body doesn't have any problem of like being here and being somewhere else at the same time. No, it's no problem at all. She doesn't have a need to be seen in only one location. That's our demand. That's our demand, that appearances only be in one location. It can't be in two locations at the same time. It didn't have any limitation on where her body could appear. Her body could appear everywhere at once, actually. but that would freak people out. But certainly they could handle it by location because they'd had a culture of experiencing that. So she would be talking in a room or visiting in a room with devotees, you know. At the same time, her body would be 1,000 miles away helping somebody out, talking to somebody else had a problem. Or she could be, who knows, 3, 4, 5 places at once or 1,000 places at once. But definitely, they shared notes, said, wait a minute, we were right here in this room at this day, at this time, and they'd meet up with the devotee, would come to visit them, said, no, on that very day, same time, she was 1,000 miles away in a train station arranging me to get a ticket to somewhere because I was stranded. They said, are you sure it was her? I said, absolutely positive. I mean, in the flesh, 100% in the flesh, dealing with practical matters, you know, happened all the time, actually. Now, here in the West, we freak us out, right? So we're super impoverished, actually. The whole Western paradigm is a very impoverished paradigm of solving problems. And the whole play is there are no problems. The non-arising of problems. It's not that problems are an interpretation. So there's one way of interpreting the world that the problems are arising. There's another way of interpreting that no problems are arising, actually. And that's actually the interpretation that is aligns with truth. It's impossible for truth to have any problems whatsoever. Totally impossible. So, because of our continuity fear, we have to work with interpretations. So one way of interpreting the world is that there are problems arising. Another way of interpreting it is there are no problems arising. And there's a play of that going on, okay? That you don't immediately completely accept there are no problems arising. You have to get used to abiding in this, and the spiritual path gets you more and more used to abiding in this. So theoretically, you could hang out with someone who has zero continuity fear if you are have worked enough on this. Now, I got an invitation to visit Jesus' dwelling place. Well, he has zero continuity fear. So that means Jesus says, you're capable of hanging out with me with zero continuity fear. You're capable of it. Well, a large part of that was studying the life of Sri Anandamayi Ma and getting used to that. I totally accepted it. I mean, everything that happened in her life, I said, I believe it. I know it's true. And I understood it. So it was, you know, extremely helpful to do that. And so, yeah, sure. Someone's bilocating to this, that's no big deal. It is a little bit of a, you know, a little bit of a wow. There's a wow, sure, there's a wow factor and all of that. Someone, she suddenly stuck out her foot. She was talking to someone, she suddenly stuck out her foot and a cobra, you know, struck her foot and bit her foot, a big king cobra. And that cobra was actually going to bite the leg of a devotee she was talking with. And they freaked out. They said, oh my God, you're gonna die. Where's the doctor? And she just said, no, there's no worry. Don't worry about it. And so it was a little bit red for a little while, then poof, vanished. And they said, what happened? I said, no, nothing, no problem. Didn't even, nothing, no reaction hardly. But she allowed a little reaction. So it would seem like, well, at least there's a little, you have some problems, right? Yeah, just minor problems with this. But actually, there wouldn't even need to be any bite marks, but you needed then to see the bite marks, see the redness, all this stuff. Oh, okay, you have a little problem. So it was this constant play of devotees saying, we need to see what your problems are. And she's saying, I don't have any problems. But they said, well, we can't hang out with you if you don't have any problems. She says, well, okay, let's negotiate this. I'll pretend to have a little bit of problems. They say, okay, you know, but you also have to realize that sometimes you have to realize I don't have problems. They say, well, okay. So they kind of make a deal. You know, it's an ongoing negotiation, actually. This is a spiritual path. It's really an ongoing negotiation, which gradually moves you towards recognizing, I don't need problems. I don't need to solve any problems. Obviously, what you need to say, I don't need to solve any problems. Therefore, I don't need any problems. Meaning you're repentant. I don't need to be other than God. I don't need to try and fragment out this endless chaos and solve it a bit at a time, piece at a time, piece at a time. Don't need it. So I've always wanted to have that opportunity, you know. How fortunate those people were. I just feel like in this world now, in this Western paradigm, we're the modern New World Order paradigm, we are so impoverished. It's like ghastly poverty, actually. And this is something I've worked on. I try to bring a zero continuity being into this world, into the West, because I say, I'll hang out with them. I'm willing to hang out. And maybe, you know, they'll come just so I can hang out with them. It hasn't worked, unfortunately. I tried as hard as I could, did everything I could to make that possible. Hanging out with a zero continuity fear presence. And, you know, we're just not ready for it. Maybe I'm not ready for it. Maybe just collectively, you know, there was, you know, so many people came this year in India. So I don't think just one person saying, you know, let's do it. So I tried to get other people to do it, you know, to be along. Let's do it. Let's do this. We can do this. And it hasn't worked. It hasn't worked. It could just be a sign of the times, actually, is the intensity of this new cycle is so tempting to people that they're not really able to hang out with someone in this world who's free of continuity fear. So it may be necessary to go to another dwelling place. That is possible. You know, it is definite possibility. When Jesus says, hey, would you like to visit my home, my dwelling place? I said, sure. I said, okay, let's do that. So I said, yeah, let's do it. He said, okay, great. He says, very close by, very close by. Well, he could be saying it's not in this world, actually. It's possible. Because this world seems to be intensely dedicated to problem solving now. It's gone in that direction, seemingly irrevocably in that direction. So people would not really benefit from a continuity-free being here. They just wouldn't get it. You know, it would freak them out. It would put them under too much stress, actually. Feeling of trying to choose between two. See, in India, it was okay if you said, hey, I'm not solving any problems. I'm just sitting here all day meditating. That's great. People say, oh, that's great. It's so much easier to hang out with a zero continuity fear of being. What are you doing? Oh, we're just hanging out. Oh, that's the highest thing. That's tremendous. They don't say, are you working? How do you make a living? No one said, no. Here, have some rice. Here, I have some rice for you. Here, have some food. This is great. Keep doing what you're doing. Because they're wise enough to realize this is benefiting the whole culture. This is supremely beneficial for everyone. So, of course, if you're a household, if you're a business person, I mean, the business people supported her to the utmost, as did the politicians. Everybody did. They said, wow, this is a tremendous blessing upon the whole land here. This is fantastic. Whatever you want, here. So, if you're hanging out with that, hey, here's food, here's lodging, here's transportation, whatever you need. This is fantastic. This is super helpful. Here in the West, we don't have that realization whatsoever. You know, we're just saying, what's our tax write-off? How can we use this as a tool to solve problems? That's the only mindset we have here. And that's a supremely impoverished mindset. Destitute mindset. And so the way I look at myself is I've taken on this destitute mindset of destitution, bad health, all these things that I have, just because the people here are demanding that. They're demanding that. That's the price you have to pay if you want to appear here as a zero continuity being. This is the price they're demanding of you. Now, so it may be necessary to go somewhere else because the demand here is so extremely... And they say, well, solve the problem of our abundance, solve these problems, you know, of our, you know, there are no problems, such problems. That is, you're not abiding in the non-dual absolute where you see there are no problems arising. That's what you have to do. There are no problems arising. You're not some superhero here to solve problems. It's all an illusion. It's all a mirage. It's all self-deception. We're spirit. There are no problems arising for spirit. And as such, we don't need to use the body as a problem device. So we literally, our body could be perfectly youthful eternally without the slightest problem, not even the need for food, rest, ultimately even air, actually. It's just an appearance. If all these needs we put upon appearances don't need those, don't, appearances don't need nature. Okay, let me tell you that. Appearances don't need nature at all, the forces of nature. In other words, again, Sri Nandamayamaya, I think she said she doesn't even need to breathe. She says this body has absolutely no needs whatsoever, natural needs, in order to appear to you. None. It's only because you want to see it that way, that I'm breathing, that I'm pretending to sleep, eating, all of this stuff. You know, she says it doesn't have any needs at all. An appearance can just be an appearance. The whole idea that we need nature in order for appearance is ridiculous. That's the superimposition. Nature is the superimposition of problematicalness. It's not true. Like that tree, I don't need that tree to be part of nature in order to see the tree. Not at all. And that's that way with everything. So a body can appear just exactly the same as we look right now, and that that body hasn't had the slightest need whatsoever. And all of appearance can appear that way. We can see all of the world that way. And that's the vision of oneness, is, I believe, is like that. Is we call it calling super nature, but it's really just appearance, problematic free appearance. You do not need to see nature at all. You do not need to see nature. Seeing nature is seeing the rising of problems. It's your desire for problems to arise. Now, Marie Watts, the great American mystic, saw it this way. She saw everything like super nature. She saw a tree in her yard, and it was like perfect. It's the most beautiful, perfect tree. But other people would see the tree was all bent over, been hit and broken here, and you know. Now she saw everything as like perfect. Like, wow, look at this appearance. She was seeing appearance, nature-free appearance. Appearance free of problems. So it's not like when you drop problems are not arising that you can't see appearance. Of course you can. You're just seeing appearance totally free of nature, of forces. Totally free of all forces we call nature. That's why people see an old Nandamayamaya and they drop the need to see problems. They'd see her just as an appearance, as this perfect, perfectly healthy, a flawless, you know, young being, so to speak. And then we'd superimpose nature over upon that appearance. So we can see it all formed, all appearances that we see now with our sensory, our body perception. We can see that spiritually as perfect, just a perfect appearance, which is, has not the slightest need whatsoever, is not affected by any forces or nature in the slightest bit. Full stop on this information, full stop here. So we don't need a natural world. We can certainly dwell in a supernatural world. Seeing the natural world is a demand to see problems arise. But there aren't any problems for appearances, actually. Is it? It's the way we're insisting on light, this appearances to play, that gives the impression that there are problems for appearances. The greatest deception is nature and perception of nature. It's a total hallucination. There's a demand that this is what we'd be seeing. And of course, you know, nature worshiping is worshiping of problems, and therefore the attempt to solve the problems. You see, the unrepentant pagan mindset is worships problems and worships the great mother, which is nature, which gives rise to this appearance of endless problems. That's what they worship. That's what they want. Because that gives them the opportunity then to try and solve problems. So of course, there we're all, we're so thankful we have this nature, you know. I've never been interested in nature that way. It's like, I don't want to see nature. Well, what do I want to see nature for? It's ridiculous. I don't want to study nature. I mean, pagans love studying nature, you know, scientists looking at. There's nothing to study. Well, why study? That's trying to solve problems. You can see all of what you call nature appearances in a flawless way, with completely problem-free, without anything ever going to cause any problem to any of it ever. You can see that instead. And they say, no, we don't want that. So all seeing of nature is fear-based. Nature is fear-based. Worshipping the goddess, the great, is fear-based. The one that keeps churning out these bodies, forms, problems, nature. That's all fear-based. It's all a reaction of defending against endless chaos. And it's still the pride of spirit saying, there's a way that I can be greater than God, other than God, except from God. There's a way. We just take a lot of time and space in order to get there. We've got to solve a lot of problems. But we can do it. We can separate out chaos. Remember, endless chaos. How do you solve endless chaos? Right? Because reality is endless. And where is there the end to then to the problems, trying to solve endlessness, huh? It's ridiculous. Of course there isn't. Is it just a futile death march? Nature's a futile death march. So the great seer Marie Watts, American, hanging out with her would have been fantastic. And not many people did at all. It's almost unknown. But she did see. She did see perfection everywhere. Absolutely. She wasn't quite on par. She still had some continuity issues, for sure. But a lot of them had gone. You know, there's an example of what happens when the continuity fear drops down. Sri Sri Ananda, my ma had zero continuity fear. Zero. In fact, never had any. Had never had any continuity fear. Not someone who had continuity fear and then had dropped it. She said she had never had any. Never had fallen into delusion. Never. Zero. Zero, zero. So it was completely natural to her to have zero continuity fear like that. And she looked at it as a very interesting play to pretend to have some. Enjoyed it. All the while, not having any. Zero. It was zero times zero. Zero times zero. There. Perfect zero times zero. Marie Watts here in the U.S. Certainly expressed the correct, you know, vision of perfection. Seeing supernature, as it were. And she saw that a lot of the time. Amazing. Really amazing testimony. And it was very natural for her. You know, it's easy. It's like tremendous. But super rare. Do you ever hear about that? Super rare. And this is becoming almost unknown now in our problem-solving mania that high technology has brought a mania with it. The world is manic. Now keep in mind that bipolarism, manic, was followed by depression. So, you know, the manic depressive. You go through a mania and then you fall into this horrible depression. You just can't do anything. There's a huge risk of that with this world, the mania of problem solving. Because you just give it everything you got and you still haven't, it still hasn't worked. And then you're seeing that just goes on endlessly and gets more and more intense and just like collapse. Instead of admitting, or instead of repenting, and working on your continuity fear, you end up collapsing. It's still pride. Collapse is still pride. 100% pride. What I've found is the closer I get to, you know, dropping continuity fear, at least to a large extent, the more the demands of the world are upon me to collapse. to collapse, to have severe deprivation, severe sickness, severe fatigue, all the stuff that the world insists of stopping to work on the problems. It insists that it's only because of a collapse of our health, our energy, all the stuff that we want to keep working. It's just that our health collapsed as we can. That's still unrepentant entirely. It has not even started on the spiritual path. And so this is the world now. This is the way the world is. It hasn't even started. Most in the world have not even started. And yet they think that they've done a lot because they think they've solved a lot of problems. That's not repentance at all. So I'm finding it very difficult to function here, to stay here, because the demands are so extreme now. And what people are saying is, no, what you have to do is you have to help us solve our problems of abundance, solve our problems. I want a new car, I want this, you know, in other words, get what I want. So you have all these affirmations mixing up non-dual teaching with abundance teaching, okay? And that's what the world wants, you see? But that is not the answer at all. That is not the answer. Declarations and affirmations are very helpful, yes, but not in the line of trying to gain abundance for yourself here. What you need to see is supernature, no problems arising. Appearance doesn't need problems to appear. Nothing, no appearance needs any problem in order to appear and to continue to appear. It doesn't have any needs. It doesn't need to eat, sleep, do anything. It's just an appearance. It's just our appearance. From living light makes the appearance. Living light is not needy. There aren't any problems arising. So, full stop with this. We don't struggle with it. Full stop here. You see, we think we have a problem with abundance and getting stuff because everything is disappearing here constantly and has needs. It falls apart. It gets old. We need to replace it. If you see supernature, appearance without neediness, what do we need? What's our problem? There isn't any. Our body, if we want to have a body, body doesn't have any needs. It's perfectly healthy. No strain. It feels everything's effortless. We want a tree, a house, okay? It disappears there. It's not under any threat of not appearing. It doesn't need to be watered. You don't need to water your plants. It's just an appearance. But no, we're insisting on biology, reproduction, process, see nature. We're insisting on nature. Just drop your insistence on nature. Okay, stop saying, yeah, we live in nature, but we can learn to affirm abundance. That's delusion. That's the ego. That's the ego. We say, well, that's not real. I want to figure out how to grow this plant with fertilizer and water and the right sunlight and put it in the right position. That's problem solving. If you want a beautiful plant, just ask for a beautiful plant. The appearance of a beautiful, if you want the appearance of a beautiful plant, just ask for it. There it is. And it will give the appearance of a tinge of nature, as it were. Okay, so we don't want to just like look up of a picture, right? In other words, like a picture. We want a 3D, we want a 3D plant. Okay, fine, 3D plant. And it can give just the slightest tinge of nature, so to speak, that's used. But don't need to fertilize it, don't need to water it. It's completely lush at all times. It's radiant health at all times. You don't have to do anything for that to be that way. That's nice here in California with this drought, right? We think, oh my God, everything's going to disappear. All these appearances in nature. Well, we don't need any of these appearances. We can see supernature and experience that. supernature can be in the same place as a lot of these plants, the trees. We can see this tree and see the supernatural appearance of this tree. So everything can appear the same that way. And, or also, we can also see it because they're looking for nature. I only see nature is what we say here. In other words, I only see problems. Is that, that's a boast here. No, we only see nature here. We don't see supernature. We're like super advanced. We're moving forward, moving on towards problem solving. That's just an endless dead end. It's an endless dead end. And it's not recognizing the dead endedness of it. Eventually you recognize, like, wow, this is just a whole dead end. Reality doesn't need nature at all. Nature is totally made up. It's just a mirage, actually, of problems. So we can work on solving problems. We think we can believe that we're solving problems. But there really ultimately are no problems whatsoever with appearance. No problems with the living light. No problems with reality whatsoever. None. So the answer to why am I not seeing supernature? Continuity fear. There's no other reason. And it's the collective continuity fear of this planet right now, which is so difficult for me. For instance, Marie Watts, when she lived, the continuity fear was much, much less. You could go out in places like she lived way out in the boondocks, in a little tiny place in Nevada or something. You know, there was so little pressure there. She could just be in her little house there and just see, you know, perfect appearance of perfect supernature. And she had a few friends that visit her, and then they were okay with that. Yeah, this is simpler. Now, you know, there's just this ferocious beast that is upon this planet, of the continuity fear, of demand for problems. And it's much, much more difficult. Much more difficult. Which is a possibility that the rapture will happen. I call it the relocation. The shift. The shift might happen. The shift might happen. Now, how's the shift happen? Well, you can see supernature. You start seeing supernature. And in the seeing of supernature, you're aware of how to simply walk into another realm, actually. Just go right into it. You see how it's right there for you. The way you will know, you will see it. And others who insist on seeing only nature won't even see it. They won't see it. And you just walk right into a supernatural realm. Just bodily, you just go walk right into it. That they'll be like portals or something, but the other people won't even see it. As if you just like disappear or something. So the people who exit this will just see my people just disappeared. But for them, no, they just walked like on a pathway, just walked through the gate or just walked straight into the supernatural realm. Piece of cake. Remember that supernatural realm is there right now. It's we're simply demanding that we see problems, only see problems. We're demanding we see nature, okay? We're demanding that process. And so we limit our attention, our awareness, our perception, as it were. We limit it severely, like blinders on. So we're not even able to see supernature. We take it as a fierce pride that we're not seeing supernature. We take it as a sign of sanity that we're not seeing supernature. Actually, it's a sign of futility and spiritual pride. So when Jesus said, we're going to prepare a dwelling place for you, and, you know, I'll come back to for you at the end of the age, and the way you will know, you know, how to get there, and the way you will know at that time, you will know how to do it. Well, this is how I see. This is how to do it. How to do it. You drop your continuity fear enough so you allow yourself to see supernature, and then you can just see how to do it. It's right there. It's right there. You don't need a natural appearance anymore. You can have a supernatural appearance, but you can appear exactly the same as this body. Exactly the same. And even you can even appear both to people who see nature and also in supernature. That's possible too. Probably. I don't know. We'll see. But the idea of maybe having to take a flying saucer somewhere and go somewhere, probably not. You know? Maybe for those who have a certain level of continuity fear, that's one way. But you might really be able to literally just walk right into it. Just walk right into the realm. Just walk right into it. We don't realize how limited we are by insisting on seeing nature. The land of problems, the realm of problems. Therefore, opportunity to solve problems, which we think we need. We don't need it. All we need to do is repent. All we need to do is repent. So when Jesus said, "Do you want to come visit my house?" I said, "Sure, let's go, let's do it." I didn't ask how. He said, "It's close by." I said, "Okay, okay." And I thought, okay, now see, how am I going to get there? But I said, "Well, I know there must be a way. There must be a way, so I'm not worried about it." So that's the full stop in information. Always come to a full stop. Don't struggle with it. Just absorb it. Wow. Wow. See? This is wow information, as I promise in my videos. I'm going to bring something that is just really wow. And you need the full stop. Don't struggle. Full stop. Don't struggle. So I say, listen in the mood of repentance. Otherwise, your mind will get way too activated into problem solving. We're not problem solving here, really. But because of the continuity issue, it may seem as if a little bit is like that, but in a different way, right? We're basically saying we don't need problems. We don't need it to be problematical. We just walk straight in. There's no problem there. So seeing supernature would be a very good next step, I would say. And I'm feeling more comfortable with that. You don't need to see nature as nature. You don't need to see appearance as nature. You don't need to see appearance as nature at all. That's a booby prize. That's the booby prize. You don't need it. They have no need for that. Spirit has no need for that, actually. Reality has no need for nature, for you to see nature at all. Again, reality does not need for anyone to see nature. Reality doesn't need nature at all. And we certainly don't need, therefore, certainly, as one with reality, as reality, we don't need to see nature either. We can certainly see appearance, need-free appearance. We can see it right now. We can see it right now. People claim, well, after they die, you know, they can see all this, you know, near-death stuff. People saying, yeah, when you die, it's like fantastic, blah, 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 blah. Sure, but we can do it right now. That's the whole point of this, is doing it here, now. Just because the afterlife seems nicer than here doesn't mean you're freed from delusion at all. Does not. But seeing it supernature here is truly saying, I don't need nature. That's really getting it, right? While doing it while you're here in this world. Saying, I don't need to see this world. I don't need to see this world. The world of process and nature. I can see a world of supernatural appearance. Need-free, problem-free appearance. I can see that world. So this is, this is doable. I know that it's doable. Now, whether the continuity fear will allow this, you know, as far as how intense it is, I don't know. But I believe yes. Yes, somehow we're going to do it. Okay, I'll get this one up here. And just hang in there. We're making tremendous progress here. Tremendous progress, as you should be able to see in this video. Just then full stop it. Say, okay, full stop. Don't struggle with it. I got it. And I just don't need to do anything more. I'm just, okay. The vibe is here. Full stop it. And we'll do a little period of cool down period here, actually, which is helpful for this. Don't struggle with the information. And for sure, this is the most advanced information I've ever given out, for sure. Now, this is really getting down to the nitty-gritty, so it's great, it's wonderful. So we're here, we don't need to struggle, we just accept, that we're here. When you struggle intellectually with this, you're basically saying, are we here? Did we really get here? Is this a dream? Is it, you know, you're pinching yourself, like, wait a minute, I'm not sure if this really happened. Yes, it did happen. So honor that it happened. Don't struggle with it. Honor that it happened. We did get this far. Honor that it happened. We're here now. And we're comfortable. We're getting comfortable with this information, right? Absolutely. Don't struggle. How am I going to apply this? I mean, just honor the fact you got this far. That's all. Honor the fact you got this far. That we've gotten this far. Honor it, honor it, honor it. This is tremendous, tremendous, tremendous. Beautiful day here. Feels like autumn. Seems like autumn has come a month early here in California. Just like summer came a month early. It seems like all the seasons are a month early now. So they're definitely changed. Of course, in supernature, you can see the atmosphere and the season is perfect. Perfect. A microclimate, perfect microclimate, as it were. Everything's perfect. Just an appearance. Flies are zipping around. Fly saying it's time to end the video. All right. Don't do anything with the information. Don't do anything. Don't struggle with it. Spend your time honoring where you've gotten to. See, this is the all important. Believe it. Say, no, I have gotten this far. If you get in this mode, say, wait a minute, did I really get this far? And how do I solve the problems with this? That's not a proper measurement of how far you've gotten. Remember, we're getting to the point where we don't need to measure any problem solvingness at all, which is why we see supernature. There's nothing to measure. We don't need to measure problem solving anymore. So don't try to measure, you know, how much problem solving you've got, how far you've come in problem solving, because then it'll confuse you, get completely confused. Just honor you've gotten this far and say, yeah, wow, this is great. This is super. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus, for helping out. Thank you, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, for giving such an incredible, amazing, super example. Just a tremendous, tremendous example. That's just super helpful. Thank you for that. Thank you for all the teachers who have helped us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, again, for getting us this far. We're very eager to go further, right? Very eager to go further. We'll let this settle in, and then we'll go further. All right. Very great. That's it.